There is a sovereign country right in the heart of Europe you've probably never heard about. Following the First World War, the Kingdom of Italy was given, in accordance with the Treaty of London of 1915, lands in what was formerly the Austro-Hungarian Empire. Having occupied less than had been promised to Rome, the kingdom, following certain actions by a certain military officer Gabriele D'Annunzio, exerted further pressure on Yugoslavia and on the international community, thus occupying even more of the borderlands. The area was settled in its majority by Slovenes and Croats. As such, Italy began the process of Italianization of those lands, which soon spiraled into genocidal action and brutal repression under the fascist regime of Mussolini. With the Second World War and the capitulation of Italy in 1943, Germany invaded the area and secured a foothold there. Only by 1945 did the Yugoslav partisans, led by Marshal Josip Broz Tito, manage to liberate the region. Given the strategic prominence of the area and factors of the international community, parts of the disputed regions were transferred under the military administration of the Allied forces. In 1947, the Treaty of Peace between Allied nations and Italy was signed in Paris, creating the buffer region of the free territory of Trieste between the renewed entities of Italy and Yugoslavia. The constitution of the Free Territory of Trieste was defined within the Treaty of Peace, and the responsibility and authority to implement it had been assumed by the UN Security Council. The treaty, which defined the territory, also defined its borders, rights and conditions. It included the establishment of an international free port in Trieste. The Free Territory of Trieste was divided into two zones, Zone A in the north, and Zone B in the south. It was independent of all legislative and constitutional actions of Yugoslavia and Italy and fully sovereign. The effective authority over the zone, the legislative branch of power with de facto royalist powers, was the governor elected by the United Nations. Below the governor, there was the popular assembly, which in effect only contributed symbolic, purposeless and sub-executive maneuvers. Trieste, also addressed as Trst or Trieste in local languages, became an international free port, the only of its importance in Europe. It was responsible only to its own people and to the international law, never to the legislative or constitutional determinants of Rome or Belgrade. Its economic development was for its time surprisingly democratic and sustainable, and the city thrived in cooperation with its diaspora, the region, and all states of the world. Quite soon, the supranational reach of the Cold War came to affect Trieste, or Trst, if you prefer. Permanent members of the UN Security Council would come to veto each other's proposals of governors. At one point, the US would block the Soviet proposal to assign governorship to a Swiss national who was just a year earlier proposed to be a governor by the US, only to be vetoed by the Soviets that time. Further, disagreements in the international community made it harder to supply Trst with sufficient fundings, and it soon had to rely on exploitation of third world nations in its newly imperialistic approach to the conduct of trade. By 1954, the situation became dire. The people of Trieste were rallying in opposition to the governor of Trst, who had many citizens arrested. The powers of Yugoslavia and Italy found themselves in constant disagreement over their claims over the border region. As the city of Gorica had been ceded to Italy with the end of the Second World War, Tito decided it was high time to build a Yugoslav city just there, named New Gorica, just to show Yugoslav urbanist strength and the Yugoslav will to secure the territory just over the border. At the same time, many circles of the Italian government were infested by both the mafia and revanchist politicians, who wished to once again see the Treaty of Rapallo be reintroduced, attempting to extend Italian influence further into Slavic lands. Tanks were deployed to the border between Italy and Yugoslavia. The world took their sides, backing Italy. Momentarily, it appeared that their will to influence the border region, especially thirst, would trigger a war as never seen before, a chain reaction of nations, concluding in a nuclear catastrophe and annihilation of humanity. Right as tensions culminated in serious danger to the international community, the UN once again failed to introduce a decree regarding the governorship. The people of the region thus stood up. Demonstrations culminated in serious unrest and deaths, growing into a revolution. A truly democratic and locally founded free territory of Trieste could be secured at that very moment. However, the governments of Italy, Yugoslavia, and the administrating UK and USA found this whole situation uncomfortable, to say the least. At the last moment, the London Memorandum of Understanding was signed between London, Washington, Belgrade, and Rome. The forces of the UK and the US pulled out of the region, Italy secured civil administration of the Zone A, and Yugoslavia of the Zone B, as thirst was to remain sovereign, its citizens sovereign, and empowered against the police of the two administrative powers, and effectively independence was to continue. Following this, however, Rome and Belgrade exerted pressure to change the territory from a freely developing and international region into an integrated maritime zone of two respectable national entities. This culminated in 1974 when the Treaty of Osimo was signed between Italy and Yugoslavia. With it, the effective partial civil administration and oversight by Italy and Yugoslavia would result in occupation of the two areas. Port of Trst was neglected and abused. Its international liberties, prominence, rights and development were stripped away by Italy. The development of the region crumbled. Post-industrial power of the free territory collapsed to a null, especially in the Zone A. There, revanchists and the corrupt administration exhorted the port for their own benefits. Over $450 million per year, just as per the port. The scholarization of the region was abruptly cut down. The bilinguality or triangulism of the region was in effect dismissed, especially in Italy, where all administrative effects were Italianized. Suicide rates were pushed through the roof, and almost all educated youth left the region. After the breakup of Yugoslavia, the role of Belgrade was simply assumed by Croatia and Slovenia. The two, led by Italy, through the cultural genocide and destruction of citizen rights, devastated the area. The population completely lost hope of ever re-establishing the free territory and began to accept the administration of Italy, Slovenia and Croatia as absolute, rightful, and began to respond to it as if the free countries had sovereignty over the regions, which they did not have, and still do not. In 2013, faced by the truth about thirst, the Thirst NGO was founded. It has ever since been advocating for the right of Trieste to its sovereignty, the right of its citizens to citizenship, the right to development, and the three or bilinguality of the region. The biggest demonstrations in the region since 1954 were organized. 14,000 signatures were delivered to the United Nations, reporting the violations of the Italian administration on the territory and requesting the appointment of a governor. Countless speeches were delivered at the United Nations office at Geneva, office of the High Commissioner for Human Rights, sessions of the Forum of Minority Issues of the UN, the sessions of the Committee on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights, and the sessions of the Human Rights Council. As of today, the judicial systems within the territory have once again been pressured to underline the sovereignty of thirst. Time and again, the citizens, when approached by the police and tried before the Italian administration, called on the judge to recognize their personal lack of authority to try citizens in the free territory of Trieste. Unsurprisingly, the judicial system stopped proceedings against any and all such citizens unconditionally. The sovereignty of Trst is still legally intact, and this is recognized, and Trst should be using its liberties to its own administration, being semi-administered by the international community. The steps which remain for the regional sovereignty to assert itself fully are as follows. Firstly, the scholarization of the population of the free territory of Trieste and the promotion of awareness of the issue among the local population. Secondly, the identity shift among the population. It must come to, in its majority, come to the understanding it legally resides within the free territory of Trieste, and that is no fairy tale, as they may currently perceive it as. Thirdly, the execution of sovereignty through constant questioning of the sovereignty of the administrative powers of Croatia, Slovenia and Italy. Only through this process and through the pressure on the UN Security Council to reconsider the issue can the region of Trst assert its sovereignty, secure the right of its people to citizenship, to development and to the freedom of language. The free territory of Trieste is a sovereign and democratic country. It answers not to Italian, Slovenian or Croatian law. To its people, the right to post liminum is true. There is very little than a few legal processes spanning the few years to come, separating Trst from the realization of its legal rights. Trst should, given its circumstances, be declared one of, if not the capital city of human rights by all relevant organizations. The freedoms of the people of the free territory of Trieste directly correlate to the goals of those who advocate for a free society, or those who strive towards a stateless, classless, and moneyless society where the means of production are controlled by the workers and the economy is decommodified. The freedoms of the people of the free territory of Trieste are in the interests of leslists and of anarcho-communists and of all leftists of this world.